Hello, everyone. Welcome to the space. We're so glad that you are able to join us today. Thank you for your patience as we set up. Yolanda, I really liked your background. I saw it for just a second, but yeah, that's nice. I like that. Very nice. Jeanette, hey there, familiar face. Hey, Jeanette. I'd love to know how many folks are here that have participated in one of these sessions before. We've been doing this now for, I think, like 5-6 months, talking about juvenile injustice system and peer support in that system and what it looks like. How many have attended? Can you maybe drop in the chat? Have you attended multiple? Which one was your favorite one? Maybe some golden nuggets of information that that you heard in one of the sessions. How about we drop that in the chat as we welcome people into the space? Buenas tardes. Hey there in New Jersey. Hey, Lynn. Lynn, have you attended these sessions before? Is this your first one? Hey, new from Mariposa. Well, welcome. Anna. Hey there. She's been here to a number of these, enjoying hearing voices from people actually doing the work. Love the mentoring session. Yay, Hannah, I'm glad that you've attended. Jane's been to a couple of them, first time to Gina. Hey there, Gina. Okay, we have some newcomers. But we're excited for our newcomers, and for folks who have attended others. We're going to go ahead and get started. Anna in Oregon, one previous meeting, reflections of mentorship and leadership. Yeah, that's been nice. Hey, Lachelle. Okay. Well, Bridget, if we can get the slide deck started. And let's hop right into it. All right. So you're in the right place. Community of practice, shifting from locking youth up to lifting youth up. This is our last session. Well, no, there's one more after this, technically, right? It's the book club. This is our last one with our panel discussion with family, peer support. And so we're super excited to have everyone here. On the next slide, you'll see a little bit about what our disclaimer is. So we are going to have this recorded. You will have access to it afterwards. Please note that although we're funded by SAMHSA, that our panelists today and our moderators, everyone that's here represents their own voice and not the voices of SAMHSA or our organization, NTAC. So just wanted to make that clear. And then also, knock on wood, hopefully this won't happen, but if it does, in case of any security issues, this session will end immediately. And then we will send you all another link to log in a separate place. So, and further instructions will be shared. I also wanted to give a big shout out to our very many partners that allow us to do the work that we do and provide these trainings to everyone. And so I'm not going to read them all, but you know who you are if you're in the room. Shout out to you. We appreciate you so much. And also on the next slide, we'll see here some of the services that our partners help us to do. So we provide individual consultation, peer learning exchanges. There are lots of ways that you all can engage with us at NTAC. So we do hope that you are, one, hopefully you're on our listserv, right? If you're on our listserv, you'll get announcements about all the things that we offer. Including, I got to put a plug in here, including our national summit that will happen May 9th through 11th. You'll see right above my head, and there's a QR code over here. This is a no-cost summit. It's 3 days where you'll have opportunities to learn, share, network. So we hope that you'll participate in the summit that's coming up in May. Okay, so we get these questions a lot, y'all, so we want to answer them up front. We do, and we can provide a certificate of completion. Just send an email to Bridget. We will post this presentation online, and we'll also share the recording with you. So if you like to listen to reruns or you want to share this with somebody, you'll receive a recording after this event. Give us about 2 business days. And then I think that's all that I need to say from this slide. So let's keep on rolling. All right, so today we are talking with some phenomenal, phenomenal people who provide family peer support, and we're going to hear from their lens and their expertise. So with that, I'm going to pass the mic over to Evelyn and our awesome, phenomenal speakers today. Oh, there's an intact overview. We'll skip over that since we started a little late. You all know who we are. Make sure you join our listserv so you can stay connected. And now I will pass it over to Evelyn.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Ashley. Hi, everybody. Welcome. I am Evelyn Clark, and I'm super excited that you are here today. All of these sessions have just really been hard work for everybody. We are dedicated, and I know all of you are dedicated to making sure that we fight the injustices within the system for our young people and families. So again, thank you for being here today. All right, so we're gonna get started with there I am again, hello. So again, I work on the NTAC Center and I work for Change Matrix. And super excited. I also have lived experience within the juvenile injustice system, and I've worked with youth and families over the past 15 years within this system and other systems of care. And this work is near and dear to my heart. Thank you. So today's panelists, I'm super excited to see these wonderful faces. You're going to hear from them in just a little bit. They're going to share their wisdom and knowledge, because we know that this is our last session, but this is probably one of the most powerful, because we know that families have the answer. And so you will hear from them in just a little bit. Thank you. All right, so we'll just take a moment to ground ourselves this morning or afternoon. We just wanted to also put out there that we know that maybe some of the conversation or just the content could be, you know, a little triggering to those who have the lived experience. And so, you know, feel free to, you know, do what you need to do during that time. And I'm also going to start us off with a virtual land acknowledgement today. Since our activities are shared digitally to the internet, let's also take a moment to consider the legacy of colonization embedded within the technology, structures, and ways of thinking we use every day. We are using equipment and high-speed internet not available in many Indigenous communities. Even the technologies that are central to much of the art we make leave significant carbon footprints, contributing to change in climate that disproportionately affect Indigenous peoples worldwide. I invite you to join us in acknowledging all of this, as well as our shared responsibility to make good of this time and for each of us to consider our roles in reconciliation, decolonization, and allyship. We also acknowledge that this country would not exist if it wasn't for the free enslaved labor of Black people. We honor the legacy of the African and Black life, knowledge and skills stolen due to violence and white supremacy. While the movement for justice and liberation is building, and we are witnessing the power of the people, many are still being met with violence and even being killed. Please join me in a moment of silence in honor of Black Indigenous ancestors who have passed and who have paved the way for us. And thank you for sharing that moment. All right, so we're gonna start off with this video this again could bring up some feelings and emotions, but we wanted to start off with this because again, as we know that families have the answer to fighting the traumas within the young people that they care for. Does anyone hear sound? I don't hear any.
I don't hear any sound. Bridget, okay. Are you sharing your sound?
One moment. Sorry about that, friends.
No worries at all. Oh, I also forgot to mention, we are going to be giving away books today. You'll see a little bit more about the book in just a few moments, but it's called Burning Down the House, The End of Juvenile Prison. We will be having the author along with a young person who is currently incarcerated. We'll be leading that book hour April 18th. There'll be more information, but just wanted to say we're gonna call on some of you for participation and you'll get a free book today.
Sorry about that. We are ready to go.
Thank you. No worries.
Say you're here, but I don't feel it. Give me peace, but then you steal it. Watch them laugh at all my secrets. Scream and yell, but I feel speechless. Ask for help, you call it weakness. Lied and promise. Me my freedom. Grab my hand, I'm drowning. I feel my heart pounding. you so proudly. Traumas, they surround me. I wish you just love me back.
Thank you. Yes, give me peace, but then you steal it. And that's so often what we hear young people voice that have been inside this system. All right, so now we get to break up in small groups. And the question is, how can you support family voice and choice, particularly within the juvenile injustice system, but also in the other systems that I know all of you are working in currently. So we'll also join you in the groups to kind of start the conversation. And so we shall see you in just a minute. And we'll have about 7 to 10 minutes.
Rooms are opening now. Please let me know if you need any help. What are our famous words after breakout groups on every Zoom? Is there wasn't enough time.
Yeah.
Our group was great. I was excited. I gave out 2 books. during our book or during our breakout.
Wait, there was book. There was giveaways in your breakout room.
I know. I want to give away a book too. I want to give my book away to Jeremy because Jeremy has.
I feel bad now.
Yay. Look, we're excited that you all are here. We're excited that we're again at our final session. So we're happy to give away books today. Awesome. Ooh, and I see Jeremy, you're from Progress Pushers. I love y'all. We had Eddie on our January session.
Yep, I appreciate you guys. I think we had a youth speak in that same session.
Yes, Izzy. Yeah,
Izzy, he's my youth, so I was really excited. I actually was a part of that call too, just listening in. I allowed them to do the work, but I did listen in, and I loved it, man. Izzy's great. This is a youth that transitioned from being diverted from a robbery charge a year ago, right? And now he's just, he does this kind of stuff all the time. He would run this if you guys allowed him to, for sure.
Hey. That's what it's all about.
For sure.
He's amazing. Thank you so much for all you do. All right. Well, I think we're ready to continue on. So here's the book that we are all excited to give away today. We're going to just take a few moments to give an overview of what the book is. And then again, we have Nell Bernstein will be with us April 18th to talk about her book along with a young person she currently works with who is incarcerated. All right.
The book Burning Down the House, I think the best way that I would describe it is it tells the stories behind those pictures and it tells the stories behind the data. The kids who are always the most powerful voices, the survivors of youth incarceration, are really who's front and center in this book. Burning Down the House, Nell Bernstein.
The book is children's stories, and that's what I'm gonna share with you today.
You know, the biggest revelation for me in learning the history of the juvenile justice system was that there was never a moment when we went off course. There's this idea that we once had a golden age of rehabilitation, and over the years, the system became punitive. But it turns out it was a punitive, abusive system from day one.
The greatest predictor that a particular individual is going to be arrested and incarcerated as an adult is juvenile incarceration.
The common theme that ran through everybody's description of being incarcerated was dehumanization. Over and over, kids said things like, treated like an animal, I felt like an animal. The physical atmosphere, the coils of razor wire, the sort of chilly, minimalist environment, very bare, concrete bunk, metal toilet, everything about it conveyed that message that you were an animal in a cage.
I hate to see you like this. You want grandma to come see you?
They gonna think that you just try to help people. It's gonna help you, right?
Listen.
Well,
I know I don't.
This might be crazy.
So one of the arguments for sending young kids to juvenile facilities is that they will get services there with mental health issues, with drug issues, with problems they're having in school. I mean, the disconnect there is so immense. Education is usually pretty minimal. I think a third of kids end up in solitary at some point where they literally get a worksheet slipped under the door. Mental health services aside, being incarcerated is incredibly damaging to your mental health. And again, solitary confinement is tremendously destructive to a kid's mental health. You know, so that's the gap between what we think we're doing and what we're doing. So many kids have been through so much trauma when they go in that they're very often re-traumatized. A lot of suicide attempts, a fair number of successful suicides. But beyond that, Many went in having experienced some pretty significant trauma and came out with full-blown PTSD.
Hold on, listen to what I'm telling you. You're charged with two things: possession of marijuana and resisting arrest.
I don't want to be. I just spent the year of my life incarcerated.
When I told people I was writing a book that would make an argument against juvenile prisons, the main thing I heard was, well, where are you going to put them instead? I think put them is our mentality. And that really made me ask, is there any value to incarcerating a kid?
Once they leave their room from SAG and once they come into their cell, they're shackled and handcuffed. So it's a secured movement from to anywhere they go, it's always secured.
I think I mentioned earlier that juvenile incarceration is the greatest predictor of adult incarceration. It doubles the chances that an individual will go on to be an adult criminal. And if that's so, there's no other logical conclusion than putting kids in juvenile prisons is a real threat to public safety. So with very few exceptions, I ended up believing no. This is just an obsolete institution.
I'm not going. I'm not. I refuse.
Yeah. Wow is right. And we can take a moment because I know, especially for our panelists, they have lived this and currently are living this. Thank you. Can we get the slides of our presenters, please?
Say that one more time.
I was asking to get up the slide with
you. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
All right. So here we are. Hang in there. We're going to have a discussion again about family peer support. And we just want to honor each individual here today that are going to be speaking because, like I said, they have lived it, are living it, and they're also doing phenomenal work to help other families while they are currently going through the pain of this injustice system. So without further ado, I'm going to start with Jeanette, and how we're going to do this is introduce yourself as your name, your role, and your why for this work.
First, I want to say thank you for inviting me. For those who are here for the first time, you're in for a treat when it comes to me and what I want to talk about. First, I was like, can we get this started? And I did come in a little late, but I'm sorry. Because we're doing that peer support here. We're building community because we're closing prisons down. That's my why. My why is the hope that we all have because this horrible system that has just ripped our families apart for far too long. The work is challenging. And some of us may be invited. Some of us may not. I don't have power. No one can empower me. But I could have influence in how I work with families, the type of support we should be giving families, whatever system. So my name is Jeanette Bocanegra. I am the executive director with Justice for Families. I have so much that I want to share, but I also know that we have a limited amount of time. But I'm easy to find. I'm in the Bronx, New York. And that my why is because I'm one of those families. That back then in 2010, when a book was being written, my son and many other kids were going through that horrible system and coming back where now we gotta put those pieces together. I also have another suggestion for a book, The Rage of Innocence. how America criminalizes our Black and brown children. That's my why. So I'm here. Thank you for the invite. I hope I don't get kicked off. Virtual world will push me out quickly. But I'm easy to find, Jeanette Bocanegra at Justice for Families. So I'm here to just share what I experienced as a parent and what I'm still experiencing as a parent and my why to why I'm building community capacity so that we don't need any system to disrupt or dictate the future of our children. They gifted, they talented, and they beautiful. I'm gonna mute myself because I gotta share the screen.
We love you so much. Thank you. Awesome. Let's go to Crystal.
Well, good morning, everyone. I have to follow Jeanette. I said, my name is Crystal Livingston. I am a mom as well, a mother of four. I am a certified peer counselor, trainer. For why specifically in Washington State. I am just passionate about this because this is me too, right? My kids living with, you know, various different mental health, behavior health challenges long before I knew what they were, right? And I think for me, that is one of my biggest whys. All I heard was they were bad. All I heard is that, you know, they need to be removed from school, but not the whys, you know, and not understanding. And mind you, I was working for the school districts, you know, and as I became a provider, you know, I'm still facing a lot of the challenges and barriers to getting effective supports. My kids tell me, you know, they want help, they need help. But, you know, when they go to reach out, there's so much discrimination. There's so much, you know, they can't just be sick, you know, they have to be drug seeking because of, you know, they're Black and brown, right? And so for me, that is one of my whys. You know, we need effective supports and services. Our youth, us parents need to be able to feel safe enough to call and reach out for support when we need them and not worry about, you know, it's going to possibly be ending their life, right? I want to be able to utilize and navigate those supports and services that I need and know that, you know, the person on the other end of the line is going to be culturally, you know, understanding of the different things, how we present, right? How my neurodivergent 19-year-old is not trying to hurt you. They're being symptomatic and we want to get them support. So, you know, I'm just excited to be here with you all. And, you know, like I said, as I share, you know, what my lived experience, both professionally and personally, but yeah, that is my why. I want to be able to not be scared to navigate this life and these systems, you know, that are supposed to be there for all of us.
Yes, thank you so much. We appreciate you. All right, Miss Lynn.
I'm so happy to be here with a mic that's working now. My name is Lynn Ausley. I'm from Tacoma, Washington. My role in this meeting is I have been co-facilitating for the past 8 years the Pierce County Juvenile Court Family Council, which is a family council made up of parents and young people with lived experience who have been impacted by the juvenile court system. We have been able to push change in Pierce County Juvenile Court, and we've got a lot more work to do, but we are at the table giving advice and feedback and on policies inside the juvenile court. And my paid job is doing the same sort of thing, engaging youth and family voice in our nonprofit organizations that are serving youth with justice involved court in the Pierce County Juvenile Court. My why is, well, I'm a mom and a grandma. I have three sons who identify as Black and seven grandsons who identify as Black. And for the past 8 years, this is my nightmare, my challenge, my opportunity. That book could have had my son in it. He would have just fit in another one of those pages. And it's really, I'm really pushing trying to identify and help families with Black and Brown families, because my son at 17 years old was pleading with his lawyer and pleading me to tell the judge and the prosecutor that he was white. I don't want a family to go through that, another family, another child. It impacted our whole family. But at 17 years old, for a Black young man who was so proud to be Black to beg me to tell them that he was white, tell them you're white, mom, because he could see why he's sitting there with $1 million bail and can't get out. He could see white kids his same age being released on their own recognizance to their parents or being released on home monitoring. So this is still happening in Pierce County. And my son was a youth charged as an adult. And I think we have 10 youth right now in Pierce County being charged as adults. And that's my passion, because 8 years later, these parents and youth are still going through the same thing. And until it changes and the policies change, this is my why. And family support is exactly what we're doing here in this webinar. My mentor is Jeanette Bocanegra from the Boogie Down Bronx, and she helped me get through and to get through this and to help other families. Evelyn was my son's peer, and Crystal has helped me along the way as well. So that is family support right there, what we're doing. And it doesn't matter where you are. I'm in Tacoma, Washington, and Jeanette continues to support. We support each other and to do this work, because no child anywhere and no parents or family or grandparents anywhere should have to go through this. Not just the incarceration, but when they do come home, and my son is not home yet, but when they do come home, living that journey as well. So thank you. And I don't want to get kicked off either. So thanks, Evelyn. I'll hand it back to you.
No kicking off at all. This is why we're here. So let's just have a conversation. I appreciate, again, all of you and sharing your stories, and know that, they're not in vain, and you guys are supporting other families and providing that hope. And that's what it's all about. So I would just love to hear from all of you. Go ahead.
I want to jump in, because we only got a little bit of time, right? Time go by quick, and we all have our expertise and passion to share. But what I learned back in 2010, and Crystal, I used to work with the schools for many years, helping families navigate whether it was bilingual education or a special ed education. Or we always wanted to support our families and our community. I'm born and raised in the Bronx, and the schools, that was always my passion until 2010, right? My youngest of six. And when he introduced me to what we call today, and we've been calling it, I just didn't know, the school to prison pipeline, mm-hmm. right? From suspension to detention to incarceration. Mm-hmm. I've always been passionate about the communities we live in, right? We want to live in great, safe communities that are clean and that are resourced. We don't want our children, when we don't know, and as parents in schools, when we share certain things, it becomes a case, right?
Right.
A case against the family. I don't know how many parents gave birth to a manual and a kid, and you still learning, and you still with that manual. Well, I'm still learning how to be a parent to a young man who was raised by prison from 14 to 20. He's 27 now. Mm-hmm. And I'm still trying to put all those pieces that they broke. So when we talk about incarceration, and not investing in education. You know, there's a saying, a political figure says, when you close a school door, you're opening up a prison door. So when we close those prisons, and I'm glad that our New York State prior commissioner closed 25 youth facilities here in New York. We changed the law of criminal responsibility, but that's by supporting families so that they can feel comfortable enough to do what Lynn is doing. Look at those policies, right? Those practices that are horrible. So it starts with the schools. How do we tackle doing the advocacy and the support for families at the school level so that we can invest those dollars? My why was also that it was costing in 2010 almost $300,000 to house one of our kids in a juvenile facility. They weren't coming back as successful model citizens. They were coming back ready to go to Rikers. And you all know and hear about Rikers. Well, we have our loved ones there. That's not a resort. It's costing us today to house one person there, $500,000 a year. And we can't even invest in our schools. We can't even invest in after-school programs. Mm-hmm. We do see that there's violence happening. There's guns violence happening all over. But we're not addressing the issues properly. We still want to go backwards now. Let's address the rooted issues, support families, right? Support the entire family, not just the one that's giving you a headache, because then it becomes that domino effect. So that mom is not focusing on one child and forgetting about the ones that are doing okay. Supporting community is what we need to do today, right? How do we support? I don't blame probation anymore for what they're supposed to be doing. The intentions are probation, fix the problem. Let's look at the child welfare as well, how they contributed. Mental health, housing, and let's go back to the schools. So until we don't tackle all those systems, we have to partner with probation because they're the only ones that are being transparent and engaging the community. How can we engage the, but then we also have to build trust. Anyway, I can just go on and go on and go on. Crystal, take it over.
Thank you so much, Jeanette, for sharing that. And you know, for me too, and again, for the families I support, that is, you know, like I said before, that educational piece is so important. And for families to learn how to advocate for themselves. You know, one of the things, you know, with my fourth child, my youngest, you know, compared to, you know, how my older kids were treated when they would be symptomatic in class or things of that nature. I started questioning and, you know, pushing back on, you know, well, he wasn't listening. And so we've put him outside of the classroom. And I think it's important for families to realize how demeaning that is, you know, when you're sat outside of the classroom for behaviors that you can't control, as opposed to checking in to see, you know, it's a start. I think it's kind of that conditioning, like, you know, being punished for, you know, things, mental health, whether it's mental health or maybe they just need a little bit more attention, whatever the case might be, but just seeing how, you know, that was happening and just being able to ask the teachers, you know, well, you know, why, you know, what was, did you guys try to identify and find out, well, what was going on as to why? And oftentimes it would be, you know, well, he's not listening because he's talking about the wheel on the car and we were just talking about the engine. I'm like, you know, right. And so again, like I was saying, just, you know, I think it's important. I have learned it's important for me and, you know, for the families that I, you know, asked for that is, you know, the educational piece around, you know, how to navigate within those systems. What are your rights? What do you want? What do you need? And not only, you know, taking that to policy here in Washington State, we have, you know, FISPERTS, which is a Family Youth System Partner Roundtable, you know, where they're able to go and talk about and meet with some of, you know, the state representation, you know, what's going on in different regions and things of that nature. But it's also, you know, different ways outside of or including wise how we can learn, you know, the different skills, the different tools, you know, how to talk about affecting policy change and, you know, being creating that brave and safe space in order for parents to be able to come and say, you know, this is system's not working for my youth. There's so much red tape here. You know, it's not that follow through of making that change. That's one thing, the talking about it, you know, trying to discover those tools, but where is the change, you know, that follow through that's affecting those different systems? So I think that's, you know, I've seen that be extremely important. That's one of the things, you know, particularly as a Black woman, you know, with multi-race kids too, where we see it such a huge effect on them as well. I think the census that just did in Washington State, it's like 4.5% of the people here are African Americans. And it's just like, you know, and so navigating around that for providers and folks that understand that, you know, how, you know, these youth and families need that layer of support and that cultural relevant and that cultural identity regarding to that, being able to navigate all these different systems is extremely important.
I just want to piggyback a little bit on what Crystal's saying. Schools in Pierce County are the number one refer to the juvenile court system. We have many school districts. Washington runs a little bit different, I think, than other states, but we have quite a few school districts, and we have one large school district that's prominently white, in a white neighborhood, but has been influxed with other races coming into the neighborhood, but the school doesn't reflect that. And how they deal with Black and brown kids is they refer them to the juvenile court. So trying to work with those schools, and I just really encourage you, if you want to work with the schools, we ran a focus group with some Black and brown youth from elementary to high school, and we asked them how they felt at school. And they'll tell you what they're feeling, to how a teacher will refer them to the counselor, or they'll sit in the back of the room. They're not given the same opportunities to ask questions and understand the work. They're seen as a problem. And this we heard from the focus group from both, these were Black and brown youth from both boys and girls. And it was amazing that even some of the elementary kids could relate as well. So I hear that you want the parents need to be heard, but the youth need to be heard as well with the parents. And schools have really shut parents out of conversations. They reach out to those parents who they think are involved. And I worked in the schools as well. So I would really encourage you to find a parent partner, find someone, and go sit down with the principal and talk about what, you know, what you see happening with kids if you want to get involved. There's somebody asked in the question about supporting kids that are in the juvenile system now. What we do in Pierce County, we have a family council that is really a council that works at the table with Pierce County Juvenile Court to help change policy and to recognize where they're absent. And like I said, we've been doing this for 8 years, and there has been a lot of good change. But then last week, they implemented another program where they were having peers help with diversion contracts, which is great, but they forgot to bring parents to the table. So how can these youth be supported in their decisions about what diversion program to go through if the parents aren't involved? And we really want the parents involved as well, or the caregivers, to help. So that family council helps identify those policies and changes and where there's gaps in family and youth voice at the table. But we also have a family support group called Families Supporting Families. This is an in-person support group, which we started in COVID. We had to take a backseat a little bit because we really wanted it to be in person. And we started it back up last month. And what we do is we get referrals from the juvenile court system for any parent that walks through that door, whether it's truancy, substance use, detention, wherever they're coming through the doors, we invite those parents to our family support group, which we have once a month. We provide a dinner and we provide a safe place where they can talk about and what's going on with them and their children and the journey that they are now since they're involved with juvenile court. We offer them resources. It's really just a place for them to, for us to listen. Those of us who facilitate it all have lived experience, but it's really to help them navigate this system that they're now a part of. Because when I went through the system 8 years ago, there's still the same issues that parents are going through the system 8 years later, the same issues. So we just want to give that support to parents. And that's where the juvenile court has been supportive of parents, and they understand the need for parents. And so those referrals are coming from probation officers and supervisors inside juvenile court and the detention manager, to join our family, supporting families, so that they can be around others in a safe environment and help understand this journey that they're on and how to navigate it, including how to talk to lawyers and how to get the paperwork and what their rights are as parents and what their child's rights are. Nobody talks about what the child's rights are. And then they're being interrogated as soon as they get picked up without parent involvement. So we talk about all those things. So I just wanted to address that question in the chat. So I'm happy to talk offline. I'll leave my email in the chat, but I just wanted to address that question and to piggyback on Jeanette and Crystal about it is these other systems and school mm-hmm. and the welfare system play a huge part.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I was jumping and just share a little snapshot of why it's important for families to get involved. And there are models that you can look at, right? Here in New York, we have the Credible Messenger, we have the Parent Support Program, and much of the Parent Support Program and engagement and partnership that has been created was through our Justice for Families report. Families Unlocking Futures. It's a data-driven report by families, for families. We were 15 organizations that provided focus groups and surveys. And in New York, once we released the report, the report highlighted the crisis in the juvenile justice system and how harmful it has been for young people and their families and communities. And through that report, we were able to create amazing partnerships. And I say amazing because they were not with the traditional suspects, commissioners and community, right? And sometimes we feel like it's intimidating, you know, folks are just powerful and can make decisions that have just, you know what, somebody say the system is doing exactly what it is created to do. Nothing different. And when something doesn't work, we look at how we're supposed to fix the individual to fit that system that is creating to do exactly what it is doing. What we need to do is how do we partner and sustain communities to continue doing the work, right? How do we provide families that peer support beyond the Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, when these issues arise? We don't normally get these resources, right? They're not normally in the community. So how do we build how we are doing here in New York, Credible Messenger, community capacity building? How do we invest in grassroots organizations that are there, that are building the trust? Because sometimes it is also hard to trust community, because we don't know if they're partnering with systems to give us the same prescription. We can't continue thinking that those traditional family functional therapy and common sense parenting is what's going to work for us. In order for families to trust, you have to start building the spaces, right? How do we help you with breathing, mindfulness, right? Yoga, like spaces where you can just, oof, I'm not alone, right? Lynn, she understands what I'm going through. Crystal understands what I'm going through, right? And Evelyn, you understand in, from a young person's perspective, right? How hard and difficult it is. And if you don't have that circle of influence around you constantly, right? Because there'll be times that you're going to fall. Just because our young people are on probation doesn't mean that they don't have to, they're not entitled to go through what they normally, a young person has to go through for their development. You know, they're on probation and you're not supposed to sneeze. Why? Mm-hmm. You're not supposed to blink the wrong way. You're not supposed to sit on that corner. Like we disrupt as well how to build relationship, right? How do we support these? This is a yoga session and I think I'm being too loud. You know?
You're so funny. Oh,
I'm just gonna mute myself. But we also do trainings for families. How do we provide families those additional tools so that you can feel that you have the influence, right? With these tools to build the home in our community, to build those resources, right? We also do community peer navigators. How do we support you in tackling that one system that's harming you? Can it be the school? Can it be the justice system? Is it housing issues? There's policies that I didn't even realize that's to even go use a bathroom. Like, let's look at what works and what doesn't work. Get rid of it. COVID highlighted that. COVID highlighted that there's disparities across every system. Families need support. Young people need support. Community need resources. We can no longer now go backwards. Mm-hmm. We've made significant changes after our report as well with families. Mm-hmm. We see family engagement specialists. We see family navigators, family advisory teams, right? Councils. So we do have them. We do have those families that are passionate, right? How do we now support those who are working with these policies and change the practice? Mm-hmm. The practices have harmed us as well. And many of those who practice look like us.
Oh, Jeanette, there's a question for you in the panel here in the chat too. Brianna was interested. Are there any virtual support groups for parents with system involved youth or any mechanisms for parents to find a mentoring family? Y'all know about anything virtual to connect?
You know, there are virtual support groups, right? And we have to connect families to support groups. I do them in person, right? We got our monthly women's circle. Every week, we got two sessions of some type of activity, whether it's crochet, mindfulness, a cooking class, learning that systems are harmful, right? How do you, in your community, right, create that? You can start with one or two person that are feeling the same way. You know, we look for folks from around the country to give us the solution to where you're at, right? We can guide you and invite you to our space and even create a link so you can sit with us. But how do we give you the tools so you can create those spaces in your community, right? Where you're that one-stop person and you're building the capacity of your team to support other families. I know you can do it. You know, Lynn, share her email. I'll put my email. I'll put my phone number. You can look into our website, sign up for our newsletters. There are so many things that you can do in your community. And if one person shows up, that's okay. The following week, two people are going to show up. We get discouraged quickly, right? We get discouraged because we set up a room. We made phone calls. We posted flyers. We outsourced every way, every whatever we can do to get them in here. It's not easy the first time. Remember, families are dealing with systems and communities that have been ripped apart. And trust is the biggest one to find right now. Create those spaces, right? Have some cookies, have some tea. Put some board games, right? Some coloring books, some paint. Build that trust first. You know, when young people are referred to counseling, right? Therapy. It takes 4 or 5 sessions for them to get, let their guards down and trust someone. And by the time they do, they got a new therapist. And now you got to start all over again. Tell me why you here. Tell me what got you here. I said that already. I dealt with 10 traumas after the one I was referred to you for. So families want to trust that if we share a challenge, that it's not going to be a case built against me.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Thank you. I would love to, we have a couple minutes and just would love for some participants to ask some questions. If you wanted to come off mute, raise your hand so you can directly talk to our wonderful panelists.
I have a question. What do you think is the best way, and this is for any other panelists, to engage county commissioners and county level leadership in work like you guys are doing?
You know, we do have relationships across the country with various jurisdictions. We are also supported by an amazing organization called the Annie Casey Foundations from the beginning of investing in the report release and continuing supporting us as an organization with the expertise on how to engage systems and families. And we can, you know, I don't want to name drop, but sometimes we got to name drop, right? Who do we, who can we reach out that respects the work that we're doing that can make those connections? Because this is about relationship and connections, right? Who can I connect with from across the country? This is a puzzle. This is a huge puzzle. Let me show you how big this puzzle is. No, this is a small one. You know, this is a big puzzle, right? You see all these little tiny little puzzles? It's like you got to figure out how to put it together without seeing the picture, right? And you start with that one piece, and that one piece is you. Mm-hmm. Or it may be me, Evelyn, Crystal, Lynn, so that we can figure out to put this beautiful picture that may need, that is going to meet the needs of that family and that community. Sometimes we just see ourselves alone, but the picture is big. And we're not trying to change a system, right, that was created yesterday. We're trying to change a system that has criminalized our kids for far too long, right? And some of us, we may say from slavery days, and we need to abolish it, right? But we're also talking about relationship, right? And how do we communicate and build trust? There's folks as well that they're comfortable with a job, and that's okay. So how do we transfer those jobs, right, that are so system rooted into jobs that are more vocational trainings, right? Spaces to heal and grow and learn. How do we repurpose a prison if we're going to close it down so that they're not saying, all right, where am I going to work? Some folks that work in those prisons, there's generational families working there. You disrupting that now. Don't mess with my bread and butter. So how do we repurpose and provide the same level of support that we want for communities and and young people? We don't want to disrupt somebody else's family, right? But we don't want somebody else's family to benefit at the back of our children. Enough is enough.
Jeanette is right on. I think just to piggyback on that, we in Pierce County, I think I can tell you from our mistake is when you invite somebody to your table, and that's what we do. We invite them to our world. We don't go to them. We ask them to come to us, to come to the families. Mm-hmm. I think what we can learn from one of our mistakes is it's not the councilman or the mayor can't fix the problem. And I think that's sometimes we send, we have families that are fed up with their kids and want them locked up because they think that's the answer, but that's not the answer. I think when you invite city council members or politicians to your group, you want to have an idea of what you as a parent group, as a community, as a PTA want from the councilman, the police, the sheriff, the politician. Because what happens too often is we get them at our table and then we say, you need to do this and you need to fix this. They can't fix it. It's our community and we have to fix it. It's our families, we have to fix it. We need their buy-in and we need their support, but we need to give them the tools and the ideas that these are our neighborhoods that we want to take care of. This is what kind of support we need from the councilmen. And still 8 years later, we have some police that don't, that won't come to our table, and some councilmen and women that won't come to our table. But you have, Jeanette's right, you have to build a relationship, and somewhere someone has a relationship with a member or a politician and can get them at the table so that you can have a discussion about what you need from them, not what we need them to fix, because they can't fix it. Their answer is throw away the key and put them in jail.
Can I jump in? You know, at one time, somebody asked me about a magic wand, right? And if it depends who you ask, if you had a magic wand, right? If you ask me and Lynn and the ones who are involved, we would say invest in the schools, invest in after school programs, invest in jobs, right? What young people need, and respite places for folks can lay back and breathe. But if you ask someone that's community, right? But it doesn't have a clue of what it means to build community. And they see all the violence, they're gonna say, well, we need more law enforcement in our block. You know, like we need a car to be parked in the where my community, there's cops parked in every corner. So I know about the violence. I'm in there, right? But I'm not gonna say we need more cops. We need more resources. Mm-hmm. We need more programs that can support and strengthen young people and give them options. But if you ask someone that doesn't really understand, we need more school safety officers because these kids are acting up so crazy. We need to invest in what we know today young people and their families need. And much of it has to do with pro-social programs, right? How do we provide these pro-social programs and meet the emotional need of our development? Because even at my age, I'm still developing and I'm still trying to not be too passionate, and I'm trying to lower my voice right now because someone said, Jeanette, the session.
I think for me, pretty much that's, you know, piggybacking on what both Lynn and Jeanette was saying, being that parent once upon a time, and I still do this, it was important for me to learn what was out there. I started volunteering. You know, I started looking up what I needed as far as like government pages, because someone said, well, go talk to this person. I'm like, well, how do I talk to that person? I have no idea how to make that connection with them. And I, lo and behold, I found out, oh, there's all these different open meetings. There's all these different things. I know Lynn said, we're inviting them to the table. For me, before I learned to invite them to my table, I needed to go find out what they were all about. And so I would just go to these different things and I would volunteer and get to know folks and start networking. You know, there's different things, you know, throughout the community that I did. And that ended up eventually me sitting on the Behavioral Health Advisory Board. And then we have something called the MID, which is, you know, mental health and drug and disability tax here in Washington State that's supposed to help with, you know, a lot of the supports and services that we're talking about. But it was, for me, I needed to educate myself. I needed to learn, you know, how to navigate, what, not only just to navigate, but what was all out there. Because like I said before, when I first, you know, started talking, no one told me about all this different stuff. I had no idea all these things that were in our communities or even where to begin to start reaching out for supports. I had to find that for myself. And so, you know, one of the things I definitely encourage and, you know, utilize too with the youth and families that, you know, we train or support is, you know, do you know what's in your neighborhoods? What is there? And is it working effectively? And it's amazing to me how there are pockets of people and still, and it shouldn't be because I was one of them, that do have no idea about all the different systems that are out there or supports that are out there, whether they're formal supports or grassroots supports. You know, one of the, you know, Jeanette was speaking about, you know, we need more than 9 to 5. Okay, my kids are not just having issues between 9 and 5 struggles. My kids are having issues on Saturdays at 9 p.m. I might need some support. So we found out about something called GEM, which is a mentoring program here. And I heard them talking about, oh, I'm about to go meet, you know, so-and-so's mom because so-and-so's around the corner. And we about to, I'm like, I didn't know stuff like that happened anymore, right? Kind of like that grassroots, like I said, you know, it's not just 9 to 5 that we need support, but yeah, and some that can come and I'm going to come on that street corner by the store. You know, you ain't supposed to be over here and your mom been looking for you, you know? So let's get some natural supports in place. And, you know, and what do you need? You know, man, what do you need? How can we support? Even if they don't know, how can they identify that? So I think that's a big piece of it too, because a lot of, you know, a lot of us, a lot of folks just have no idea what's out there, but also we don't know what we need necessarily, you know, because we've been being told what we need all this time and just unlearning that. To be able to voice, this is what I need, and this is what I need it to look for. Like, you know, Lynn was saying, we need to let y'all know what, you know, the right supports that we need for us and not you telling us how that needs to look, right? So I just want to add that piece.
Thank you, Lynn, Jeanette, and Crystal. I appreciate your helpful responses.
I missed, who was that speaking? I missed that person's name. I want to catch it from my list.
Laquita Cozart.
Hey, Laquita. All right, gotcha.
All right. I know we have 5 minutes left, so I want to honor everybody's time. Ashley, do you feel like we have room for one more? Do we want to get closing?
We probably can squeeze in one more really quick question. If there's another one from the group.
I want to make question. Sorry. Okay. I wanted to know if anyone knows if there's any like juvenile detention centers that have been repurposed and, you know, changed that really meets the needs for young people in the country. You know, is there any model?
Well, it may not be a model, but we demolished Spofford Bridges, which was one of the detention centers here in the Bronx. And it's a beautiful building now. You know, it was meant to close prior to when they reopened it again. And they just put a lock, and next thing we know, they opened the lock and kids were going back in there. Mm-hmm. And we had to go back and say, no, you built 2 smaller ones. No need for that horrible one that's a sore eye in the community. So it was demolished. And this beautiful building, you can see it when you're in the freeway or in the highway. So yes. There are models, you know, I can just tell you that of that one, but when we close a prison, we have to make sure that we repurpose it or that it is demolished. You know, it really took me understanding my son returning home and what we need to really build the capacity of community. It's not easy, but you can start either at your home, at your church. There's places that you can start being the person to take away the stigma, right? It's a stigma. And if we criminalize families for what system have done, then you will not open up the conversation. But if you can, it's a fashion statement here to come into this office. You got to have a system involvement to be welcome with open arms. And I would even say, let's open some champagne. Because we're going to demolish them, right? It's about talking about it, sitting down and say, how are we going to repurpose them? Maybe that's harsh. Repurpose them. So also using language that can support us in that vision. How do we build community and repurpose some of these places?
Okay. Thank you.
Love that. All right. Well, thank you again. And if we can give our panelists a virtual hand clap, we so appreciate your time, your expertise, your stories, and all that you do. Thank you for being here and closing us off in this series. And I'm going to turn it over to Ashley to close us out.
Yeah, so we gave away several books. So keep an eye out for your email. We're going to ask you about how we can get those books mailed out to you. And please attend the session on April 18th. I want to give a big shout out to Jeanette, who's going to be joining us for our summit. If you like what Jeanette had to share, I know I did. I could listen to Jeanette all day. You will see in the chat, there is a registration for the free summit, virtual summit online. We have over 50 speakers, several hours worth of continuation education credit units that you can receive by participating in the summit. So please join us May 9th through the 11th. Bridget dropped the registration link in the chat and share the registration link. If you're already registered, share it with your friends, share it with your family, your colleagues, your coworkers. We want to see you there. I want to give a big shout out also to Evelyn. Y'all, all of this started with an idea that Evelyn had months and months, and I think even a year ago, she started with this idea to bring the community together to talk about how we repurpose the juvenile justice system and how we can make a difference in our community. So thank you to Evelyn for bringing almost 800 people together. We've had almost 800 people participate over the past few months, so thank you. There's a survey at the end. Please take this survey so we can continue to bring you all trainings that you wanna hear about. So please take part in the survey. It only takes a few minutes for you to help us be better and provide you with what you need and what you want. I think that's it for the day. I've already talked about the things here. Thank y'all so much for being here. Thank you so much. Stay connected with us, and we hope to see you at the next session, April 18th. We'll see you then. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Ashley, I had a quick question. I don't know if you could help me. I tried joining the listservs as the links were coming up.